But the night before Christmas, when all through the house, not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care, in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there. The children were nestled, all snuggled in beds, while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. Then Mama in a kerchief, and I in my cap, had just settled down for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash. Well, what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and eight tiny reindeer, with a little old driver so lively and quick. I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles his horses they came, and he whistled and he shouted and he called them by name. Now dash and now dance and now prance around Victor. Ah, domino, jubilo, donner and blitzen. The top of the fort to the top of the wall. Now dash away, dash away, dash away all. So up to the housetop the horses they flew, with a sleigh full of toys and St. Nicholas too. And then in a twinkling I heard on the roof the prance again, pawing up each little hoof. As I drew in my head, was turning it around, down the chimney St. Nick came with the bound. He dressed all in fur from his head to his foot. Clothes were all covered with ashes and soot. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes how to twinkle, his dimples how merry, his cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard on his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and a smoking head circled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. He's chubby and plump, a right jolly old elf, and I laughed when I saw him in spite of myself. He spoke not a word but went straight to his work and filled all the stockings and turned with a jerk. Crazy, and laying his finger aside off his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to a sleigh, to his team gave a whistle. Away they all flew like the down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim ere he drove out of sight,
"Happy Christmas to all, and to all a good night."
This is Andrew LeGank, and you're listening to that Twilighty show about that zone. Tonight, we are talking about the second season episodes, the Christmas-themed Night of the Meek, and a Western farce called Dust. Ho, 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 ho!
Welcome to that Twilighty Christmassy show about that Christmassy merry Yuletide zone.
Joyous Yuletide!
This is the second episode, I guess, aired in the video format, shot on video. Night of the Meek, starring the great Art Carney as a boozy department store Santa Claus. And he doesn't have a very promising start. He's upending the bottle at a local watering hole. Is this supposed to be New York City, you think?
It kind of has that feel, but then it also has that feel of the Twilight Zone that's just shot in whatever place they could find on the lot that wasn't sort of busy, you know.
It might have been like a street set that was based on New York.
Yeah, kind of. Like, it really does. It doesn't have anything that really differentiates it from anywhere else. It's like, you know, it's another one of the lower budget, you know, though they're all pretty low budget episodes. They as a matter of fact, Dust actually is one of the nicer production value episodes of
Dust was filmed though. That was,
and this one's a little lower. This one's like in the middle. They do go outside, but the fake snow is really bad. I mean, like,
yeah,
I'm
know
be
that
critiquing
was, that,
cause
I
it's
had
Twilight
an issue
Zone
with
episode,
the snow. I thought that it looked like laundry soap.
It kind of did.
There's but a great bit where he's drinking in the bar while children are knocking on the windows because they see Santa Claus.
Yeah, and he's all trashed and like, yeah.
And there's a great character actor in there who plays the bartender by the name of Val Avery. He's been in everything, and he threatens the guy dressed up in the Santa Claus like a costume with physical violence because he's like sneaking shots. This is really I mean, like, you remember that movie Bad Santa with Billy Bob Thornton?
Hell,
I think?
Yeah, that was my description of this episode was like, Art Carney is Bad Santa. You know, it's like That's with a just, heart, you know, is like
he, yeah, he has a heart, but yeah, I got a feeling that he has seen some stuff.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
So these kids come up to him and tell them what they, you know, he goes out, he gets kicked out. They tell him what these kids tell him what they want for Christmas, and he starts crying right there. He's like holding these kids on the street, crying. And he's like, "Why are you crying, Santa?" It's just, it's weird. It's so maudlin, right?
Mommy, Santa was mean to me.
Of course, his boss Santa is played by, funny, like, another mommy. Great character actor, John Fielder, who you know you've seen in a million things on TV. He was Jack the Ripper in a famous Star Trek episode, Wolf in the Fold.
Everybody keep back! I'll kill her! I'll kill her! Keep back!
Be careful. You're going to hurt somebody with that thing.
You suffer, you. I'll kill all.
Let's get him to the transporter room quick. You.
Die, 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 everybody.
He also appeared in a couple of odd couple episodes, usually playing strict authority figures.
This whole thing is getting out of hand. I want you and Madison out of here in the morning. I'm afraid you're just not our kind of people.
You're quite right, Mr. Duke. We're not your kind of people. We don't go around yanking other men's ex-wives' upper arms. May I order? Security's a wonderful thing, Mr. Duke, but not at this price. Not with sneaky peepee cameras and three-way locks and two-way mirrors.
Who told you about the mirrors?
This city is tough enough to live in without people like you exploiting men's fears. You're a horrible little man with a horrible little mind who has to yank people's arms to get attention. And we're moving out of here at once. And I'm not even cleaning up.
Oh, was that great, Phoenix? I couldn't have said it better.
You've been saying it all along, but I just didn't have enough sense to listen.
You're the kind of people who don't appreciate anything. I had you spotted as pinkos, troublemakers, the minute you set foot in my office. This is the safest, most fully protected bed.
Mr. Duke!
Mel, what happened?
Boss, we've been robbed. They took the computers, the scanner cameras, everything.
Come on, Mel!
He shows up, Art Carney shows up to his job drunk, dressed as Santa, like you would, and Fielder fires him on the spot.
All I know is that I'm an aging, purposeless relic of another time, and I live in a dirty rooming house on a street filled with hungry kids and shabby people, where the only thing to come down the chimney on Christmas Eve is more poverty.
Will you keep your voice down?
You know another reason why I drink, Mr. Dundee? So that when I walk down the tenements, I can really think it's the North Pole and the children are elves, and that I'm really Santa Claus, bringing them a bag of wondrous gifts for all of them.
Now, these days, if you fire a department store Santa Claus, he comes back later with a Remington double barrel.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Carney, no. Let's talk about our Carney.
Okay.
Okay, this is like a word, I hate to use it, but this is a tour de force performance. He's so incredible in this role. You really, you know, I know he's wearing the beard and the costume, but you really do forget that it's Art Carney.
He wears it the whole time. And he really just sort of sinks into this role and becomes this
character.
This
is seriously Emmy stuff. And I was
looking,
really
is.
You know, there were no Emmys awarded to Twilight Zone for performances or even nominated. As far as I could tell, Art Carney wasn't nominated for this. And it was just, it's really heartbreaking. I don't know if you caught this, but he's like chewing out his former boss. Okay. There's this great scene. And he says that he'd like to see the meek inherit the earth. And as he says this, the camera focuses on a black child who is nodding his head. It's a nice little moment for me. I really liked it. So then, like, the chords of the first Noel are heard, and then we hear sleigh bells, and Carney staggers down the street, finds a bag that seems to be a bag of garbage, but then he hears the sleigh bells again, and it becomes this overflowing bag of wrapped Christmas presents, and he starts shouting, Merry Christmas! So he goes to a shelter for, I guess, the indigent or something, maybe like a soup kitchen. They didn't really have homeless shelters back then, to my knowledge, but he starts handing out presents, and, of course, the cops and everybody who isn't down on their luck, assume that he stole the presents, which is kind of messed up. You know, I mean, it's like,
yeah,
I'm pretty sure you can't confiscate something you assume is stolen, right?
Yeah, no, you really can't. And that's kind of why I think why he gets let go from the police station, if I'm not mistaken.
Because they don't have they like really any can't. Proof otherwise.
They're like, yeah, you stole all this stuff. Like, yeah, dude, nothing's missing.
He's like, I want to see your receipt. I'm like, you know what? You know where my receipt is? It's up your ass.
Up your ass. Sorry, you got to bleep that out.
Thank you. Thank you for creating work for me.
No,
just because you
whatsoever.
Think something is stolen doesn't mean it is, or that you can take it away from somebody else. You would usually wait for somebody to report a theft, right?
You generally would.
Like,
yes,
my whole bag of gifts were stolen. Where are they? No
one says
that.
And, like, the store manager is, like, just assuming that he ripped off the store, and, like, they have no proof whatsoever.
Yes, well, he's a P-R-I-C-K.
You know what? But he still got that bottle of cherry brandy, didn't he?
Yeah, I know. That's, like, the one thing. He's like, what would you like for Christmas? He's like, I'd like a bottle of brandy. Well, here it is.
Nerd alert!
So this episode premiered December 23rd, 1960. It was directed by our buddy again, Jack Smite. Great job.
Good old. He did an excellent job of this one. It's a really good episode. It's a really great little Christmas story. It's really sweet.
It really is, yeah. according to the Wikipedia, the original narration ended with the words, and a Merry Christmas to each and all. But that phrase was deleted in the 1980s.
For some reason, by a bunch of politically correct bastards.
So the supernatural aspect.
Before. I don't know where that came from ever.
Of the story is about the idea of Santa Claus. After he is let go, he comes across the sleigh with the reindeer.
Mm-hmm.
And with an elfin helper who may or may not be a woman or a small or a young boy. We don't really
could
know.
Could have been transgender. We don't know.
It could be a transgender elf.
It could be.
Could absolutely be. Not a cis elf, a transgender
no, no,
elf.
No, 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 no. Not a cis elf. No.
Who identifies this person? It's really hard to identify. It's really hard to not use personal pronouns when it comes to this person. But they identify them as Santa Claus, and then Carney identifies as Santa Claus.
He does.
We've got a year of hard work ahead of us to get ready for next Christmas. Come on, are you ready?
Oh yeah.
So what is this? Is it that he forgot he was Santa Claus because he was drunk?
He's a cis Santa Claus.
He's a cis Claus.
Sorry. Ho, girlfriend.
Anyway, I'm sorry. What were you asking?
I was asking if he... Did he forget he was Santa Claus because he was drunk?
Probably.
Do you think he was like, Santa Claus decided to just slum it and get drunk? And
wait, are you talking about the very end of the episode?
The very end of the episode.
No, I think that he didn't realize that it was going to continue ever, and that was what he wanted for his wish. Like that's what he says, is like, the guy asks him, he says, did you, how come you didn't get anything for yourself? And he said, well, I got what I wanted. There was one thing I really wanted, so I want to do this again every year. And then he gets granted that wish when he walks around.
So what happened, what happened to the old Santa Claus? Did they put two behind his ear and just leave him in the back?
Maybe it's like the Santa Claus, the movie or something. They needed a new one, so like he was
so
the
he's
dude.
Tim Allen,
huh? Yeah, he could have been.
He
Tim
killed
Allen.
Santa Claus, and now they have to make
Tim Allen went to jail, and this guy needed to like replace him. You know,
he
like,
really wanted to be
Ernest saving Christmas or something.
did Ernest truly save Christmas? Because I don't think he did. I think he exacerbated the problem.
Yeah, it's true.
But I really like this episode. You like this episode too?
Yes.
And it puts a lump in my throat. Very nicely made. It would have been, you know, unfortunately, I think, as with all the video stuff, it would have been better served if it were shot on film. But that's a minor complaint.
It's got much better look than that horrible one that we, that other one, the Night of the Lameness. Or
the Night of the Lameness. That was the alternate title. The Night of the Lamest.
The Lameness of the Night, or whatever the hell that was. I don't know. The Hour.
I think it was the
lameness.
Lateness of the Hour.
Yeah, whatever.
The Lameness of the Hour.
Yeah.
So Carney was perfect, perhaps because he had experience in live television with the Honeymooners.
Right.
Hey, Merry Christmas Eve. To you, Edna.
Norton. Ah, I can see you trimming up the old tree in there, Alfie boy.
Yeah, it's going to be a beauty.
It sure is. I got a Christmas present for you.
Oh, well, hand it over.
Huh?
I say hand it over.
Ain't you got nothing for me?
Yes, I've got something for you. Merry Christmas. Well, I suppose we both gave us the same thing, a tie.
I didn't get you no necktie.
You didn't? What's in here?
How about your pair of spats?
Spats? What did you get me spats for?
Well, let's face it, Ralph. You're not the easiest guy in the world to shop for, you know. It's pretty tough to get a guy something that... Well, a guy that's got everything.
Well,
Merry Christmas, Ralph.
Merry Christmas, Norton. Anyway, I know it came from your heart.
No, it didn't. It came from the fat man's shop.
Never mind.
So our friends at VHS Rewind, Mark Giacomo and Chris Hassler, produced a pair of episodes for Christmas last year, and Hassler put on this great record, which I'm going to share for this episode. This is Art Carney performing Santa and the Doodly Boop from 1954. It's a great one.
Wow. Cool.
Once upon a time, there was a little boy named Tommy. One day, he wrote a letter to Santa Claus up in the North Pole and said, "Dear Santa, I have been a good little boy all year, so I am writing you now to say, all I want for Christmas is a doodly boop, a doodly boop, a doodly boop. All I want for Christmas is a doodly boop, thump diddly adda, doodly boop." When Santa read the letter, he was very much surprised, because he hadn't had anyone ask him for a doodly boop in a long time. It was the day before Christmas, so into the toy factory, Santa went, looking for a doodly boop. He looked high, and he looked low, but there wasn't a single doodly boop in sight. Santa went through the toy factory singing, "Has anybody seen a doodly boop, a doodly boop, a doodly boop? Has anybody seen a doodly boop, thump-diddly-adda, doodly boop?" But none of his helpers knew where there might be a doodly boop in sight. So Santa went home slowly and sadly, singing, oh, where is a doodly boop, a doodly boop, a doodly boop? Oh, where is a doodly boop? Dump diddly ada, doodly boop. When Santa came home, Mrs. Santa Claus opened the door and said to him, "Santa, you look so tired and unhappy. What's wrong?" Santa said, "Little Tommy asked for a doodly boop, a doodly boop, a doodly boop. Little Tommy asked for a doodly boop, dump diddly ada, doodly boop. But there is none in sight anywhere, and it's almost time for me to deliver my Christmas toys." "Why don't you look into the closet?" said Mrs. Santa Claus. With a start, Santa jumped up, ran over to the closet, opened the door, and out fell hundreds of doodly boops. Picking one up and putting it quickly in his bag, Santa went on his way to deliver his Christmas toys, singing, "Little Tommy's gonna get a doodly boop, a doodly boop, a doodly boop. Little Tommy's gonna get a doodly boop, 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 a doodly boop."
Next up is Dust. Rod Serling's opening narration reads like first year creative writing class. "It was a dark and stormy night.
All we are is dust in the wind, dude.
I close my eyes only for a moment, and the moment's gone. All my dreams pass before my dust in the wind. All they are is dust in the wind."
This is a Western.
Starring John A. Alonzo, futurist cinematographer extraordinaire.
There you go. Nice Casey Kasem. It looks like a Western. You have horses and homesteads, right? So
it does. It's got a really nice look to it. Actually, it's
beautifully
shot.
You know what? It's sparse. It has this kind of expressionistic feel to it. So we start on the salesman, Thomas Gomez. He goes into a jail to taunt this Mexican man who's about to be executed for the death of a little girl he ran over with his wagon wheel.
If you want something delicious and nutritious, cheese is a super snack. Look, a wagon wheel. When my get up and go has got up and went, I hanker for a hunk of cheese.
So this peddler, his name is Sykes. He's a real piece of work. He's played by Thomas Gomez, who I've seen in a million things. He has a face that you know he was like on the Dukes of Hazzard or BJ and the Bear or something like that. He's like this Lucifer.
You remember him as like this fat, mean guy. Like,
I think he might have been in Soggy Bottom USA.
Yeah, he's like, you know, he's like the Boss Hog, except he's not Boss Hog, you know.
So he's there to wind people up. He makes them angry and he makes them sad.
He's a douche.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Today, young Mr. Gallegos, killer of children, dances on the gallows.
Well, what'll it be for you today, Mr. Katz? Don't need any more rope, do you?
What do I fancy, Sykes? I'll tell you what I fancy. I'd like you to take your fat carcass and your loud mouth out into the open air. This is a small room, and it's a hot time of the morning.
That's unusual having him propel the story. I also wanted to mention John Larch, who plays the sheriff. He was in two other Twilight Zone episodes, Perchance the Dream and the first season. And then the third season, he was in It's a Good Life, a classic, as the kid's dad.
That dog, that collie dog, he doesn't like me. He's a bad dog.
Anthony, did you do something to Bill Soames' dog? Did you, son?
I put him in the cornfield. He isn't outside anymore.
Bill Soames' collie was out in the yard.
Why? Anthony put him in the cornfield. Isn't it a real good thing that he done that, honey? Isn't it a real good thing?
Is it a real good thing that he done that? A real good thing.
Dust. Premiered January 6th of 1961, the first episode of 1961, directed by Douglas Hayes, written by Serling. So everybody in this town hates the man in the jail who's about to die. His family begs for mercy. It was an accident. I mean, how many people you think got run over by wagons back in those days? Was this like a real scourge, like drunken driving or something?
Oh, I bet. Yeah, it was. I mean, as a matter of fact, like in reading some books of the era and stuff like that, and specifically not even of the era, but there's this great book called Time and Again, where a guy goes back in time to 1890s New York, and one of the things was how dangerous it was getting run over by horses. Like, really? How surprising that is. It's like how often it happened and how careful you had to be.
I have narrowly walked away with my life from so many different cars coming so fast. And a lot of these cars you can't hear until, right? It's like trains. Sometimes you can't hear the train until it's right in front of you. But I imagine horses would make a lot of noise.
Yeah, well, I mean, cars tend to make a lot of noise, too, unless they're one of those electric cars, one of them newfangled electric cars.
Oh, Prius? Prius would mow down like 30 people before it stopped.
Yeah, it probably would.
Although it has really bad torque, it would probably stop on the first person.
Yeah, dude, you can't even get that thing to accelerate to take out people. I've tried.
It hurts. You can hear it, that it's hurting it's hurting itself trying to get up a hill.
Yeah, it can't get out of its own way. I don't know. Yeah, yeah. I had to drive one of those from New York to here.
I drove a Prius.
That's what they gave me at the rental car company. Yeah, yeah. It was a sad trip.
So this is like really depressing stuff. The townspeople and the family of that girl have no compassion. This is like existential, and it's the salesman tells the family of the man in jail that he has magic dust that turns hate into love and makes people forgive. And this is, of course, a con job. He's just basically going to sell them dirt, and he's laughing too. It's not exactly a pearl of great price for like 100 pesos, which is all the money this old man has. So he is a bastard. He really is. And there's a great line from the sheriff where he says, God made man on the sixth day. He should have stopped on the fifth. That's an awesome line.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is a bit of a downer, but it is effective. Everybody's coming to the hanging. This is like television for the townspeople. They're all like, you know, come on, get your shoes on. We're going to go see the hanging.
Yeah, come on, kids. We're going to the hanging. Yeah.
The people things were a bit rough, I guess.
Gee, Mom, you think his eyes will pop out? We'll find out soon enough, dear. Like,
okay, $5 on if the guy's eyes pop out. You think the hatred of the townspeople is more along cultural and racial lines? What if it was a white man? I hate to be one of those people, Andrew, but what if it was a white man behind those bars? He's not black, though. He's Mexican. He's going to have to pay for his own hanging if Trump is president.
His life doesn't matter. Okay? Like, yeah.
This is a very, like,
I don't think it's racial lines. I think everybody there is either Mexican or a white person playing a Mexican.
So what do you think? Do you think the white people hate the Mexicans and vice versa? I mean, obviously they're trying to make the Mexicans look a little more benevolent, and they're trying to make the white people look more hateful and angry.
I didn't get that. I didn't get that there was that much of an agenda there except for, like, an anti-death penalty message. Which there definitely was.
Yeah. I mean, well, if you assume, it's obvious he did kill this little girl with his wagon.
It was an accident.
It was an accident. Yeah, it was an accident, but, you know. If he's, like, there and, like, you know.
You're saying that if he was even a white guy, they wouldn't have done that? Like, it didn't seem to me that they cared who he was. They just were, like, looking to string up somebody for killing this little girl, you know?
Okay, but did you remember there was a little bit of a line from somebody? I think it might have been the salesman. I think he might have said he was drinking when he was on the wagon. So, hey, he was drinking and he was on the wagon. Okay. But he did say something like he might have been drunk or something. You know, there was, like, drunken wagon wheel driving.
Dude, that shit was dangerous. I'm telling you, man. Like that was no joke, dude. There were.
I think horses might
that.
Make it a little safer if you're drinking, because if you're like whipping the horses to get them faster, the horses might be like, you know, I'm not going any faster. He's all right. He sells the magic dust to the old man, the kid's father. The old man sprinkles the dust. Not only does Sykes sell the dust, he also sells the rope that they use to hang the boy. Mm-hmm. So they try to hang the kid, but guess what? The rope breaks.
It's you yourself! The root ones used to me! Magic!
Come on, Sheriff Springer!
You must pay heed to the magic! It's only for love! The magic is for love! The magic is for love! Magic! Magic! You must pay heed to the magic!
Magic!
It is for love! It is for love! The magic! It's for love! No! No!
Now, what is this, okay? This is a question for you. Is this providence? Is this divine intervention?
It's divine intervention, yeah.
Or could it be that the salesman was some kind of a divine force? Maybe he was a jerk, yes, but maybe he was a divine jerk.
It seems to me like it was, I think that the salesman took it as divine intervention, which is why he gave the money away at the end.
There were these kids and they were all looking up at him and he just tosses them.
He just gives them the money that he got from.
And he looks at the rope and he's walking off and he laughs.
Actually, you know, did he walk away and laugh? I guess you're right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So maybe it was a plant thing. Maybe he wasn't an evil bastard all along. Maybe that was what his intention was, for that to happen. And he is divine somehow.
Well, I like to think that this guy had a little magic in him. Maybe a little magic.
And he knew what was going to happen.
Maybe.
Yeah. It's Mason.
It leaves a question for you, and that's. You know, I like those Twilight Zone episodes that kind of give you a question at the end. Well, what if?
What if?
And Mason agreed too.
Mason is into it. He liked this episode. He's like, you know, he's like, for a blind cat, I really liked watching this episode of Twilight
Zone. So the family of the little girl decides to let him be. So it's an interesting kind of like a stay of execution. And I mean, do you think if you put your belief in something, you give that belief power? Maybe that's what we're missing. We're giving...
Maybe.
And this is like magical realism. It's a style of writing known as magical realism. And I like that. In the end, you know, he puzzles, Sykes puzzles over the brand new rope he sold. And, you know, it's a nice ending. It's not as powerful as I would have preferred, but this is something that could have been twice its length if it just to tell a bigger story, and I would have been interested to see
that. I thought it was a very watchable episode, and I thought it was quite different from a tip what you would think of as a typical Twilight Zone episode.
Right. It's hopeful.
Yeah.
Just like the Night of the Meek. Two hopeful episodes for Christmas.
Yeah, you put those together just for Christmas. Huh? That's good. Yeah.
So this has been That Twilighty Show About That Zone. I want to thank my guests for this episode, Andrew LeGang.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Next time, I will be discussing Back There and The Whole Truth with Colin Hall. Thanks for tuning in, and please try to be kind to your local department store Santa Claus. He might just have some magic dust in his bag that will save your life one day. Good night. And Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas! Ho, ho, ho!
Santa, get your hand out of my pants.
Ho, ho, ho! Is that a Yule log, or are you just happy to see me? Ho, 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 ho! Ha, 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 ha